Welcome to another broadcast of the Lorain County Commissioners General Meeting. Unless otherwise announced, meetings are held Thursday mornings at 9:30 at the Lorain County Administration Building, 226 Middle Avenue, 4th floor, downtown Elyria. These are public meetings, and as always, you are invited to attend.
Can we stand for the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Commissioner Blair has the dog today. Welcome to the Thursday, September 3rd, 2009 Board of Commissioners meeting.
Oh, and what a dog it is. Oh, he's so precious. I think Jack was looking at some old pictures of my dog and found this fella to bring today. Oh, is he ever a priceless little puppy. Good morning. This week's featured pet is a male lab mix. Stray, found in North Ridgeville. He is in cage 35 and is eligible for adoption Saturday, September 5th at 3:00 p.m. Very gentle dog. Labs make good pets. We had one for years, rather two, a mother and child combination. So stop at our dog pound and see what we have for you, or check us on the website. Make somebody happy at your house.
Thank you, Commissioner. No quote this morning, as you're well aware, or most people are. Commissioner Kukowski is out. She had major surgery 2 weeks ago, but she is recovering. We hope to have her back next week. So if you can keep her in her prayers, we'd appreciate it. Madam Clerk?
We have a proclamation. Do you have it?
Yep.
Okay.
Elaine, you want to come up there, and we'll do the proclamation.
Good morning, Elaine.
In the matter of proclaiming September 2009 as National Alcohol and Drug Addiction Recovery Month in Lorain County, whereas treatment and recovery improve the community's welfare and provide a renewed outlook on life for those who struggle with substance use disorders and their family and friends, and whereas 23.2 million people aged 12 or older in the United States needed treatment for a substance use disorder in 2007, and 5.4 million adults also suffered from a concurrent mental illness, and whereas studies have indicated 8.9% of people who made an effort to get treatment but did not receive it were concerned that receiving treatment might cause neighbors or community members to have negative opinions of them. However, most say they would not have a negative opinion of a relative or friend in recovery from an addiction. And whereas resources exist online and in our community to increase people's awareness about how substance use disorders affect children, families, and our society, and whereas such education is essential to overcoming misconceptions and achieving long-term recovery, and whereas to help achieve this goal, the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration, the White House Office of National Drug Control Policy, and the Alcohol and Drug Addiction Services Board of Lorain County invite all residents of Lorain County, Ohio, to participate in the 20th anniversary of National Alcohol and Drug Addiction Recovery Month. Therefore, by Lorain County Board of Commissioners, by virtue of the authority vested in me by the laws of Lorain County, we do hereby proclaim the month of September 2009 as National Alcohol and Drug Addiction Recovery Month. Board of Commissioners, Ted Kallo, Betty Blair, Lori Kukowski. Elaine?
Thank you. On behalf of those individuals and families either currently suffering in treatment or now in recovery for substance abuse and addiction, we thank you for this proclamation. It's testimony that, you know, this is our month to celebrate, that treatment does work and people recover. So if we can all, you know, acknowledge, we probably all know somebody, either personally, someone we work with, or in our neighborhood that is going through this. Again, if it's time to take a minute to think that we have the support here in our community. As you said, there are resources, even though we did get budget cuts, all of our programs are still intact. There might be a little bit longer waiting list, but we do have resources in Lorain County as well. So thank you for the proclamation and considering this month.
Thank you, Elaine.
And for the work that you do.
Thank you. I have one other item on the agenda. Actually, it's John Ellis from my board, but I'm also on this piece, if I could take a minute. One of our initiatives is Communities That Care of Lorain County. We've received our second year of funding from the Office of National Drug Control Policy for drug-free communities, and we wanted to just inform of a training that's coming. It's a free training for the community. It's called The Adolescent Brain Under Construction. It'll be presented on Wednesday, September 16th. At 5:30 in the evening at the Spitzer Conference Center. It's free, open to the public. We just ask people to call for reservations, 282-9920. And there are flyers in the back as well as you have them, because as we know, adolescents are adolescents. And as we move forward with drug-free communities, that's part of our first piece of education. The final piece is starting next Monday, actually. Over 14,000 students in all the public school districts of the county in grades 6, 8, 10, and 12 will be surveyed through the Communities That Care Youth Survey. And it's basically going to give us information about what it's like to live in Lorain County from their perspective. So once we get all that data back, probably in the winter, we're going to provide you with a lot more detail on what they feel it's like to live in this county. So on behalf of our board and our providers, I'd like to thank you for your continuing support. And have a great September.
Thank you, Elaine.
Under resolutions number one, job and family services bills.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Investments.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Appropriations.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Transfers.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Requisitions.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla?
Aye.
Ms. Blair?
Aye.
Travel expenses?
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla?
Aye.
Ms. Blair?
Aye.
Bills?
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla?
Aye.
Ms. Blair?
Aye.
Under the airport, instruct the clerk to advertise for bids for the agricultural land use of the airport. Notice to be in the Chronicle and Rural Urban on September 8th and 15th and open at 2 p.m. on September 25th in the meeting room D.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla?
Aye.
Ms. Blair?
Aye.
Under the Commissioners, authorize various personnel actions as indicated on the summary sheet for employees within jurisdiction of Commissioners.
Mr. Cordez.
Thank you, Commissioner. I do have a number of issues that I want to discuss with the board. Some hires at Golden Acres. I do have some additional layoffs that I need to discuss with you with Job and Family Services. And we have a pending labor agreement that we may or may not discuss. I know time is short this morning. They're all permissible topics under the Sunshine Law, so I would request that we have an executive session at the conclusion of our regular board meeting today to do so. Thank you.
Approve and waive the reading of the same for the Lorain County Board of Commissioners meeting minutes for August 6th, 13th, and 19th.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla?
Aye.
Ms. Blair?
Aye.
Authorize the county to quit claim ownership of the 5-acre Powers parcel and the 10-acre York parcel, the parcel with the building from itself to itself relating to Green Acres.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Cordez?
Yes, sir.
This is going to tie them all together as one parcel or to split apart? I was kind of confused when we met with Flanagan 2 weeks ago and we were at the fair all week, so I didn't get clarification.
Actually, my understanding of this is going to split the one parcel apart.
I know we've worked on this for 4 years, so I mean, we're doing it
for 14
longer
years.
Than that.
Okay, the four years I've been here, I know we've worked on it.
What we have here is we have different restrictions on different portions of the entire parcel at Green Acres, the way it was deeded and willed and restricted 100 years ago.
Right.
Somewhere along the journey, somebody combined all those parcels into one parcel. And that was probably for ease of reporting, and I probably would have recommended doing the same thing. But now that we're still trying to deal with that land issue with the restrictions on a portion, there's no need to restrict all those parcels with the arduous requirements of the one. So we're going back out, splitting the parcels back out so we can deal with each one of them individually rather than having to deal with them together.
Thank you for the clarification.
Mr. Kayla?
Aye.
Ms. Blair?
Aye.
Instruct the clerk to advertise for bids for the Transportation Center Phase 2 Audiovisual Technology Contract. Notice to be in the Journal on September 8th, 15th, and 22nd. Mandatory pre-bid at 9 a.m. on September 23rd at the site and open at 2:30 p.m.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla?
Aye.
Ms. Blair?
Aye.
Instruct the clerk to advertise for the bids for the Transportation Center Phase 2 Warming Kitchen Equipment and Contract. Notice to be in the Chronicle on September 8th, 15th, and 22nd. Mandatory pre-bid at 10 a.m. on September 23rd at the site and open at 3 p.m.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Award various contracts for mechanical, plumbing, and electrical work for the train station maintenance facility. Bids were open on August 20th, and these were the most responsive, complying with specifications paid from the transit construction account. Issue notice to proceed letter on or before September 10th and complete on or before November 14th. Authorize county administrator to notify the county auditor to release retainage at completion of said project. One, Firelands Electric Lorraine in the amount of $62,125 for electrical. Lucas Plumbing and Heating in the amount of $100,900 for mechanical plumbing.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Approve change order number one to Lucas Plumbing and Heating Lorraine in the amount of $19,050 for additional plumbing work, modifications to storm and sanitary sewer system at the transportation center to be paid from Q construction account.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Commissioners, just for the record, since we've dealt with several issues with the transportation center, and since we are working very diligently in the community to maintain our current sales tax, I'd like to point out that this is federal money, not local money, that is supplying these projects. There is no additional local money or new local monies going into this project with regard to continuing to try to get this transportation center completed by the end of the year. A lot of people ask out there because they just don't understand the division of funds.
That's normally Commissioner Kukowski brings that up, and she didn't think to add that to it.
So I just want to make sure in her memory that while she's not here this week, we'll bring it up and make sure that
her memory?
Well, not even memory, but yes. I guess bad choice of words, thank God. But out of respect for her, how's that? The public needs to know that we're not using local dollars for this project. I get approached on that all the time, and I'm sure you do too.
Yes, we do.
Thank you.
Urge Congress to fully fund the $475 million Great Lakes Restoration Initiative in the President's 2010 budget proposal. These dollars will keep Lake Erie recreational, vital, and economically productive for this generation and many generations to come.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion.
Yes. The Board of Commissioners of Lorain County received a letter from Tina Skelton Wozniak, who's the President of the Board of the Lucas County Commissioners, basically Toledo, asking all of the counties along Lake Erie to urge Congress to support these dollars towards recreational development and economic development. So we received the letter last week, and our clerk was able to get it on our board business this week, urging Congress, along with Congresswoman Marcy Kaptur, Congresswoman Betty Sutton, Senator Voinovich, and Senator Brown to please keep this going forward and funding it. So thank you very much.
Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Under Community Development, award a contract to Bridge Building Company Lorain in the amount of $2,390, which includes a 10% contingency for any unforeseen changes for Kathy Nelson at 39568 Carroll Lane, Carlisle Township, to receive a grant for roof venting and repairs and wall and ceiling repairs at the kitchen stove and wall tile replacement at the kitchen stove. This is the most responsive bid complying with specifications and will be paid from the CDBG FY08 home repair account.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Support the annual comprehensive economic development strategies update for 2009-2010.
So moved.
Second. And Mr. Chairman, do we want to hear from Rebecca?
Rebecca, you want to fill us in?
Good morning, Commissioners. As you know, annually we are required to prepare a community economic development strategy, which is then submitted to the Economic Development Administration for potential funding for local economic development projects here in Lorain County. We've actually been quite successful in the past. Lorain and Elyria both have received funding. This year, the number one ranked public works project again is the water tower at the former Ford Lorain plant in the city of Lorain. We understand that EDA has asked for a pre-application, and this is moving along and should actually be funded through the EDA this year. So this is the second year that it's ranked number one, and we are very hopeful that the funding will be received for this project. In addition, Mayor Hunter in Sheffield Village would like to open up 200 acres by connecting two industrial parks in his village, and he had asked that this be placed on the SEDS. because of the because of the unemployment rates in Lorain County, the entire county is eligible this year to receive EDA funding. So we have also placed that one and the Pin Oak Parkway extension in the city of Avon Lake, which would allow for the extension of their industrial park. So we have three projects ranked this year, and the number one project is moving forward on the fast track to actually receive financing through EDA. So
wonderful.
We're pretty excited about that.
Great. Thank you, Rebecca.
Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Under sanitary, authorize a second extension of time to execute a contract with United Survey Incorporated, Oakwood Village, for the Crest Haven Eane Home Sanitary Sewer Reconstruction Phase 1, Contract 1, for 120 days.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Under workforce, approve and enter into various purchase service contracts with Lorain County Workforce Development Agency with funds available through WIA effective July 1st, 2009 through September 30, 2009. YWCA Soft Skills in School Youth, $10,000. Boys and Girls Club Work Experience, $44,000. YWCA Internship, $20,000. Urban League Tutoring Mentoring, $10,000. Boys and Girls Club Tutor Mentoring, $10,000. And Domestic Relations Juvenile Court, $3,750.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Amend Resolution 09188, adopted March 19, 2009, designated commissioners as fiscal agent effective July 1st, 2009 for Workforce Development Agency, and amend Resolution 09441, adopted June 25, 2009, amending Resolution 09391, adopted June 4th, approving and entering purchase service contracts with Workforce Institute for the operation of the Employment Network One-Stop Career Center. Said amendments are to reflect the wording authorized said payments.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Commissioners, may I just point out now that
it's like a cleanup move to me.
It is. Yeah. There is so much going on with stimulus dollars and workforce development that we're moving in and out of grants and applying for monies at a rapid pace, and we're trying to catch up with ourselves here. So this is housekeeping onto some of our contracts, because there were some waivers that were applied by the state that allowed us to extend contracts while we were waiting on additional allocations, but we needed to follow up with the resolutions, and I apologize that it took so long to get this, but we needed to house clean these things.
That's what it looked like.
Thank you.
Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Instruct the clerk to advertise for bids for Russia Road resurfacing project. Notice to be in the Chronicle on September 4th and 11th and 18th, and bids to be open at 2 p.m. on September 29th.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Authorize county engineer to sign the acknowledgement on behalf of the county for the new outfall and legal description of the sewer and easement to Fireland School District of Main Road. The existing outfall sewer is failing and is in sufficient capacity for the drainage area being served. Water from Vermillion Road, which is a county road, drains into this outfall, so the engineer has interest in seeing the outfall replaced. The easement is granted to Fireland School District with acknowledgement by the county to routine maintenance and minor repairs on the new 30-inch sewer line. Fireland's local school district Board of Education will pay $1 to Shirley Ann McGuire as executor of the last will and testament to Wilford T. Cunningham, a.k.a. Troy Cunningham, a.k.a. W.T. Cunningham, a.k.a. Wilford T. Cunningham.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Mr. Cortez, County Administrator.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. As I said, I know Commissioner Cahill has to leave early this morning, so I'll be brief. Two things. First, I once again have the prescription drug program, the NACO prescription drug program that we're part of, and we've been part of since 2006, and I'm pleased to report that we're approaching $500,000 worth of savings for our county residents for this no-cost program that we're enrolled in, vis-a-vis our membership in the National Association. So it's always nice to take a look at that number. So if anybody needs those cards, please contact the commissioner's office, specifically Sandy Strozak at 329-5760, and she can point you in the right direction for getting a card if you have an issue with not having prescription drug coverage.
Well, actually, not to continue on that, though, my assistant, Tony Ann, drops those off at the local pharmacies.
I thought you did. That's what I didn't want to. So. That would be great. So I think that the program's picking up a lot of steam and a lot of people are taking advantage of it. And I like to report that out so that occasionally people know that there is benefit to those memberships. The other thing is that, which is not as pleasant news, is that I received on the end of August the reports on the sales tax revenue from the general fund. And unfortunately, and I'm sure you've seen this, through August 24th of this year, the 0.5% that supports the general fund operations is down $1,122,000. The 0.25% that supports the jail operation is down $522,000. So we have roughly $1.6 million of decreased revenue from sales tax at this point last year. I'll pass this along. I'm not sure if you saw it. I just got through my folder myself. But the news continues to be discouraging. Hopefully September we may see an uptick in some of the sales tax from the cash for clunkers. I know that there was a lot of activity with the dealerships. How much that's going to be, I don't know, but that's going to be a one-shot deal too, because those programs only ran in for a short time and during a specific time period. I think it's important that we report out that we continue to see a decline in the revenues within Lorain County as we approach November, and we attempt to convince the public that we need to maintain this sales tax to maintain a safe community. Thank you.
Mr. Ennis, Assistant County Prosecutor.
Commissioners, I have no report this morning.
Commissioner's report.
It's nice to be back in our offices. Last week was the county fair. Very successful. I spent 6 days out there, and speaking for the criminal justice tax, we were given issue number 4, so everyone's aware it will be on the ballot. There's 3 state issues, and it's the county's turn this year to be on top. So all our dialogue with the residents last week, I think, were very positive. We had a lot of good response. I know I met with Captain Drozdowski and myself and Sheriff Stamitti and Prosecutor Will, were on both WEOL and WOBL, talking about the county needs, and our safety comes first. So we're going to be urging everyone to look at issue 4 and after much consideration, approve it. Thank you. End of my report. Go ahead. No, I was going to do this. I would tweet them all bumped together, I think.
Okay. Are you done?
Yes, I am finished, Commissioner.
I'm pleased to announce that the West Shore Commuter Rail Task Force, together with the Jet Express, in conjunction with the alternative analysis launching, is having a recognition event on the Jet Express on September the 30th. It's Wednesday. It's $25 per person leaving from the Black River Landing. And if that isn't enough, Jet Express is also having 3 trips to the Browns. The dates are Sunday, September 13th, Sunday, October 4th, and Sunday, October 25th. I've given those dates and times to Hal, but if you didn't get it and you need them, I have them. And if anybody has an interest, you're welcome to attend. The West Shore Commuter Rail is a Wednesday evening from 5:30 to 8. The Jet Express will depart at 6 p.m. from the Black River Landing.
Thank you.
The Browns, they're leaving at 11. And Commissioner Kahlo didn't mention the buyers at the fair, but I'm sure that he bought a lot of stuff because that's what he feeds his family during the year. I just brought my annual turkey, and it was fun to be there. It's fun to help the kids, and it's fun to participate in the watching all the goings on. And finally, I'd like to say that Mayor Kersenko and I were asked to give out awards at the Blessings Outreach Festival that was held a week ago Saturday, I think. And there were some 30 recipients, and it was very nice to see these people honored. It was kind of a surprise to me that on item number whatever, I also received one of the awards. John Hunter and I received awards as public officials. And mine says, as an inspiration in politics. So I want you guys to pay attention. I'm an inspiration, okay? And here it is, if you can
yes,
pick it
you
up.
Are.
Yeah, right. I won't ask you what kind of an inspiration. So I thank Lou Acosta and his committee for recognizing, and it was nice to be there. And the article in the paper said they even gave thanks for the rain, because it rained that day. And then they're an inspirational group of people. And last but not least, my favorite dinner of the year is, I looked at Elizabeth and I remembered, the Women's Equality Dinner in Oberlin, because those folks don't let you forget that we gals are equal to you guys. That's it.
Board correspondence.
Move the reading be waived.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kahlo.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Public comment.
Anyone wishing to address the board? Good morning, Shirley.
Hi. Shirley R. Johnson, Oberlin. I'd like to refer you back to item number 12 about Green Acres and ask a little further what the possible import of that might be in terms of if too much land, I have no clue as what how the land is laid out there and what the parcels are, but geez.
It's a blessing.
It's fighting me. What the consequences might be for the building itself, which I gather is the only thing there that is required to be used for a specific reason. I would hate to think it would be left with less land for, say, children to play in or whatever it might its future use might be.
Well, currently, Shirley, and what I've been working on, I've just been here 4 years, just 4 years.
Seems like forever.
Seems like forever, especially with you, Commissioner.
Yeah, right on.
But anyway, just any usage for that facility, and it is aging and been closed up, Shirley.
I know.
We have to look at other options for that facility, and there's a deed process that we're working through. And all these things we're finding with the properties were all joined together. So, I mean, currently we don't have anything going out there, but it would be nice to someday, you know, make it fruitful and a benefit to the community again. But the properties are all mixed together. So,
I don't think that 2 or 3 months goes by when I'm not contacted by Green Acres from somebody who wants to start a school or a daycare or a business out there. There's probably been, over the last 5 years, 50 contacts with regard to the property and its uses, and each and every one of those has to be turned back because of the restrictions. Right now, some of the restrictions were modified, but anything that goes in there has to be pretty much for a public use and has to support, 75% of the support has to be for children. And
say that again.
75% of the services produced there would have to be for children. It's been difficult to blend those services together without violating the deed restrictions with regard to property use. The ball fields that occupy the north side of the property and a portion of what used to be the soccer fields on the west side of the property were once an independent parcel of land that was freed from restrictions in the late 90s. The parcel that the building proper sits upon, and I'm trying to recall this from memory now, is the parcel that has the greatest deed restriction placed upon it. Separating them gives us the ability to deal more fully with lifting the restriction on the smaller parcel that the building sits upon, because we have identified known heirs that have to be specifically dealt with to modify those deed restrictions. Overall, with my discussion with each of the commissioners, we have not actually strategized a complete plan for what to do with the property, but this is a positioning for higher ground with regard to trying to release the property that the building's upon. Once that happens, I believe the intent would be, in some discussions over years now, would be to sell that property so that it could become a productive piece of property out in Oberlin. Right now, it's been boarded up for 14 years, and while we make sure it doesn't attract the wrong element and we keep the grounds cleaned, we definitely would like to see it put back on the roles of producing property for the city.
Is there any place, where is the place that one can go to see how the property is now divided?
Right now you can probably look the parcel up on the auditor's website. It's still contained as one large parcel. I don't believe you'll see any division. This is going back to title records for 100 years, and that all that information would be contained within the prosecutor's office, because they're the legal representatives working on it.
Well, will it show what you've done today? I mean, the quit claims and how they...
I don't think it'll show anything about what we've done today, and that'll probably take several days or a few weeks to catch up with the posting downstairs. But I'm sure you see Mr. Flanagan here, and Mr. Flanagan may be able to give you a more complete explanation of that, because he's our legal representative working on that.
Mr. Flanagan?
Yes, Bob Flanagan over in the prosecutor's office.
I can't quite understand you.
I'm sorry. Bob Flanagan over in the prosecutor's office.
Okay. Thank you.
Hi, Sherry Penna. I work for Commissioner Kukoski. It's kind of strange to be standing up here. But since she is not here, I know that she would want to say something about this. I'm sure everybody read about it in the newspaper. I have a memo from Ford, Ohio Assembly Plant, regarding David Hall, the Marine that was killed in action while he was serving this great country. He's the son of Dell Hall, who is also an employee at the plant. David began working for the company on July 31st, 2000. And I just wanted to have a moment of silence for him, if we could.
Without a doubt.
Thank you.
Thank you. Give our best to Lori. Anyone else looking to address the board? I move we go into executive session as outlined above.
I'll second.
Gale.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Thank you.
Unless otherwise announced, meetings are held Thursday mornings at 9:30 at the Lorain County Administration Building, 226 Middle Avenue, 4th floor, downtown Elyria. These are public meetings. And as always, you are invited to attend.
On April 1st, 2010, our nation will be counted. Every person, whoever they are, wherever they live. And what we learn will transform what we know about ourselves. The 2010 Census. It's a new portrait of America. The 2010 Census is an exciting milestone for America. It promises to deliver accurate information about our diverse and growing population. And it's important for the future of every community. Census data will be used to allocate over $300 billion in federal funds every year.
The 2010 Census will be important to the nation because it is the foundation of our democracy.
The Census, no matter when it is the consummate partnership between local, state, and federal government.
Communities use the data to plan for their future, like disaster and emergency services, healthcare services, schools, transportation, libraries, senior centers, and more. The 2010 Census builds on the success of previous censuses and is the best planned and most well-researched census ever. And innovations, like a new short census form, will help to make it even more successful. The 2010 Census, it's easy to complete. Data are always confidential and safeguarded. It's important.
This census is a commitment to the American way of life. To be counted as a resident of the United States, I think, is one of the proudest things that can happen to you in this country. It's important. Stand up for yourself. Be counted. Let people know you're out there.
The 2010 Census. It's a new portrait of America.
A photograph. Time and place, a picture holds a moment's space, a portrait of hopes and dreams, telling the story of our times. And for now we know that we're changing fast, and for now we've left the past.
the 2010 census. It's a new portrait of America.
Pedestrian injuries represent the second largest number in motor-related deaths. In the current report by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, of the 812 traffic fatalities for children ages 5 to 9, almost one-third, that's 254, were pedestrian fatalities. These numbers were just very staggering to me in this office. Most of these were from pedestrian crossings, children not educated in crossing streets where there are sidewalks and obviously stoplights, or where there are no sidewalks and there are stop signs. So basically, it was based on the fact that they aren't getting proper education, or they hadn't any education on how to cross streets with sidewalks or without sidewalks. So that's what really got us motivated to look into this and do something about it.
County Engineer's Office is quite proud to announce that the Safe Routes to School program has been initiated throughout Lorain County. We're very excited about this. To help these children from grades K to 4, teaching them to walk the streets safely is very important to us. We've seen statistics that quite frankly shock us. Many times we read and see stories of pedestrians being hit by automobiles in Lorain County, and it just tears my heart to see these children from K to 4 part of that. This program is to stop that, to help diminish those type of situations and educate these children on walking, crossing the street safely, and we're quite happy to announce that.
Most of our workshop was developed and made in-house. Simulated sidewalks, simulated streets. We have actual working stoplights. We have the pedestrian crossing signs that actually work. We have operational railroad crossings. We also have the regular road signs, like your pedestrian crossing, your stop sign, your railroad sign. So we have all of these different things that the children can not only visualize, but then we actually interact the children in those situations so they can not only see, but they can use these in their learning abilities on how to cross the streets with and without sidewalks. We've had so many good responses back from the children, and of course it's just like anything else with children. When you ask for volunteers, when you're talking in a group of 60 and you can only have 8, it's amazing at the hands that go up. You know, does anybody want to volunteer? Well, everybody wants to volunteer. We make them go over these skills that we're trying to teach them, not only the volunteers but the group as a whole. So basically we have the whole class interacting. So if they say left, right, left, behind you, in front of you once, they say it at least 8 or 10 times before the workshop is over. So we've had many teachers and many principals tell us, and we even had one child that came up to us and said, you know what, Ms. Spansky, we were going across the street the other day and we remembered look left, look right, look left. So that was very rewarding. And so I think the repetition, the interaction with the children and with the items in our workshop is very important to them and to us. Before you even go into the safety part of it, they're in awe over the traffic light, and then our railroad crossing signals actually work. So they're just like, oh, ooh. And we get up there and we tell them, and we even give them some trick questions. You know, we'll say, well, we can see that train all the way down the track. Do you think we can make it? Because you're fast and I'm fast and we can run. And of course, they're very enthusiastic. And no, we shouldn't do this. So we teach them that in some urban areas, you will not have the gates that come down to keep you actually from crossing, that you may just have two sets of tracks. And just because one goes by and the signals stop doesn't mean that another one can't come from the other direction. So we tell them it's very, very imperative that they stay back from the tracks and they wait till those signals stop and to look both ways. And even once those signals stop, to look both ways, and they should never run across the railroad tracks. They should walk and continue to look both ways because it's not safe. And they could fall. They could injure themselves if they're alone, if they're not with someone. It could be very dangerous because not only could they injure themselves, they may not have help if there is a train coming because they are so small. And as you know, some of those tracks are very large, and you're talking in kindergarten through fourth grade, some of those children are very small children. The main thing is that we tell them that only you know when it's safe. You have to make that ultimate decision. So make sure that you know that it's safe before you cross those railroad tracks or a street. One of the other things that we cover in the safety workshop, and it's also repeated in our video, children don't have that perception of the miles per hour. It's very dangerous. And the same thing with trains. We tell them that train could take, you know, forever. It's way down there. But we don't know the actual miles per hour. We decided to use two different videos. The first one is geared for kindergarten and first grade. And that is Otto the Otto, put out by AAA.
Hi, kids. A lot of times you have to walk to get to places. And when you're walking, you have to be especially careful of cars and bicycles. Oh, no! Those kids are walking the wrong way! That's dangerous. I'm going to talk with these kids. Down at the clubhouse, they're talking about the safe way to walk on streets without sidewalks.
I say you can walk across the street anywhere you want, as long as you look first.
And don't get squished flat by a car.
That's a fairly simple way of looking at safety. There are actual rules and laws for walking.
Yeah, but the most important one is you don't get squished flat.
Who's right, Maggie? Patrick or us?
I guess in a sense, everyone's right. The main idea is to get there safely, but there are some rules to help you get there safely, like don't run out into the street without looking.
The second video, we show second, third, and fourth grade. And it is put together by the National Safety Council along with Honda, and they developed the first humanoid robot.
Michael. Michael, this is Osimo.
How come you're dressed in a robot suit?
It's not a suit. I'm a real robot. My name, Osimo, stands for Advanced Step in Innovative Mobility. I'm the world's most advanced humanoid robot. I can walk forwards, backwards, and even climb stairs just like a human. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, what's the first rule about crossing the street?
Stopping at curbs.
Correct. First, always stop at the curb. Then make sure no cars are coming. You want to look left.
It's clear.
Then right to see if any cars are coming from the other direction.
That's clear too.
Cars move fast. There might already be a new car to the left. So look left again.
Car coming.
See what I mean?
Okay, he's gone.
Kids love this. They relate to Osimo as well as the younger children relate to Otto, who is an animated automobile. And he tells them about crossing streets. Osimo does the same thing, and he actually goes through with the children and tells them how to cross the street at an intersection with a traffic light, with the pedestrian crossing. He also teaches them how to cross because a lot of children at schools have parked cars. He goes over the issues of how to cross when there are parked cars. So he does a number of different things, how to cross the street when there are no sidewalks. So they both cover the basic skills. One is just geared a little bit more for the different age groups. Our response has been amazing. not only from the children. We have received numerous cards. I have a whole box of thank yous from children from the schools that have participated in our workshop. We've had nothing but a positive response back throughout the communities that we visited this year.
I think it was really nice because they had a real-life robot talk to you about safety, and you got to actually do what he said was safe. He said when there are parked cars to make sure there are no drivers in before you cross the street.
I saw that we could know what to do when there's like cars coming, not to go in the middle of the road so you don't get hurt. You have to look left, right, left, behind the shoulder, and then straight.
If they don't know how to stop at sidewalks, then I'll tell them how to. If they don't know how to cross without sidewalks, then I'll tell them how to do that too, because that's what we learned.
I think that it was good because I didn't know that you had the five ways, which were left, right, left, and then over your shoulder, and then ahead of you.
I thought that crossing the road was really good for little kids if they don't know what to do by crossing the road.
It's a good idea because, like I said, the kids could walk through the whole process of crossing streets with the crosswalk, without a crosswalk, at the intersection, what happens if you're crossing in between two parked cars. Those are things that parents don't teach their kids. They go to Safety Town and they learn left, look right, look left again, and they go. And even my own son, who's a kindergartner, he just did Safety Town, and I still catch him flying across the street. And all I have to do is say, Matthew, remember Osimo? And he stops, and he thinks, and he does all the steps that he was taught in the video.
It was a great refresher, especially Absolutely. For them, now knowing, you know, what to do and kind of even additional things that they may not have been told or considered before.
Most of the kids did their little safety program back when they were getting ready to go to kindergarten. They start out learning all those safety rules. Then as time goes on, if you don't reinforce those safety rules and keep telling them, just like we do as adults, we think we're safe. We don't have to follow those rules anymore. We can do what we want. We can take a chance and run across the road. And I think this program was very good at reinforcing the fact that even though we're growing up, we still have to be careful. We still have to follow the signs. We still have to follow the railroad crossings, especially around here in Amherst. We tend to have a little trouble with the railroad crossings and kids wanting to play on them. So I think it was a good review. I think it was done in a fun learning way, and the kids really enjoyed it. We were very happy to have everyone here at St. Joseph's School.
If it saves one life, we feel like we've made a contribution. It's our way to give back to the communities.
No one can deny the loving devotion we get from our dogs, and I think we all agree we get back more love than we give them. I'm Dick Guider. I'm reminding you, if you share your love with a dog, you'll never regret it. There's really nothing like a dog to spark up your life, whether you're a youngster, a senior citizen, or somewhere in between. And dogs have a whole lot of affection to share. Okay, is that good? You don't have to go far to hear heartwarming adoption stories.
With my husband, it is like saying man's best friend. He truly loves that dog. He feels it's part human. It's his second daughter, as Erica said. It's definitely a prize. She's queen of the house, basically. She's a good lover. She's gives us a lot of attention. She's a good girl.
We had a cat before. We had Abby. And Abby adapted very well. She is best friends with that cat. She will not harm that cat in any way. She's amazing. I love her. When I'm in bed at night, Abby will jump up with me and she will pull the covers back and she will lay under the covers and lay her head on the pillow just like a human.
I encourage anyone to go to the Lorain County Kennel to adopt a dog. It's given our family great satisfaction and a great reward.
After, you know, a bad day at work or anytime you come home, it's just always nice. They kind of turn your mood around once they come, when you come in the door, and they wagging their tails and jumping on you. And it's a great feeling to know that they're happy to see you and that they love you just as much as you love them. She is good with our other dog. She's good with people. She likes attention. And she likes to cuddle up with you.
It's funny when Lily, when you kind of discipline her sometimes when she does something bad, or she always seems to roll on her back and put her paws in the air and just look up at you with a sad look. So it's kind of hard to even get mad at her when she does something like that. So we kind of laugh at that.
And it's always amusing when she does get a spurt of energy and want to run around, and we're always like, oh my gosh, Lily's gonna play now.
Yeah, so I'm on the couch or whatever and she'll hop down and she always like tries to bite her own tail, and then that kind of like keys on our other dog Rocky to chime in and try to, you know, bite her tail a little bit, and then they start playing around a little bit.
One day we came home with some food from I just really wanted a burger, so we had a burger and I had it sitting on the tray table by the couch, and I got up for a minute and got a drink, came back, and Lily was licking her lips. She had eaten the whole thing. And I was not very happy with her, so I screamed and told Kurt to come down and get her away from me because I was just so upset. But we both lived, and I was fine afterwards. One of the best things about adopting a dog from the kennel, at least for us, was, again, just giving this dog, who knows what would have happened to her, a new life, and also giving our other dog a companion during the day. It's just fun to have the two dogs and take them for walks and watch them play, and it brought us closer as well.
You know, it just makes you feel better as a person that, you know, you're giving a dog a better chance to live a life.
Actually, I enjoy the exercise because I need to, trying to lose weight. Salem makes me get out of the house every day, and so I have to take him for a walk, even if I don't want to. And he's not that much trouble because he was pretty much housebroken when I got him from the pound. I really like the older pet because Salem was kind of, whoever had him before, they really kind of housebroken. So I didn't really have to go through the potty training deal. I just had to let him out and find a place for him to go. And I think older pets, especially for people who don't have children, are kind of good because Salem, he's real playful, but he's not, he gets tired and he lays down and he doesn't want to be bothered, and that's fine with me. So he's not always wanting to play, you know, because puppies have a lot of energy. And Salem has quite a bit of energy, but sometimes he just lays on his pillow and he's like, don't bother me, I won't bother you. And sometimes when he wants to play, he wants to play, and that's okay. I got Salem at the Lorain County Dog Pound. I found him on the internet, actually. They had his picture on the internet, and so I called and he was still there, and so I immediately went over and looked at him. We went outside and played, and he jumped in the car and wouldn't get out, and there we were. So we were on our way home. So it was love at first sight. He's a very good companion. I can always depend on him to be here and greet me with, you know, open arms when I come in the door. He's very protective of me. And he lets me know when anyone is outside or in the driveway. So I feel safe with Salem. You know, even though he's a small dog, he gives me a safe feeling just in my own home. If I'm having a bad day sometimes and I'm just not in a real good mood, you know, he'll come up and snuggle up to me like, "Hey, Mom, it's okay." I think other people should adopt a pet, and even an older dog. The Lorain County Pound has so many wonderful dogs. All you have to do is go over there and look. I mean, even now, I still go on the website and I tell Salem, "Don't you want a little brother or sister?" Because they have all these little cute dogs over there, and they all need good homes. And if you're looking to adopt a pet, I suggest you try the Lorain County Dog Pound first. I mean, you pay for the license and just a nominal fee, and you got a great dog and a great companion and somebody that's going to be in your life for the rest of your life, and they'll love you no matter what.
Hello, my fellow commissioners and I are here at the Lorain County Dog Kennel on Hadaway Street, just south of Ellery City Discount, Value City. We invite you to stop out and see the facility here. We have lots of dogs available for adoption. We also encourage all dog owners to register your dog each year and get a dog license. That's your dog's ticket home in case it gets lost. It has a number and can easily be identified so that your dog can be returned to you in case he or she might take a little walk and you are unaware of it.
Along with the regular licensing that the county requires for all dogs, we also have a special dog license. It's a special heart medical care license tag for an additional $5. And the proceeds from that go to help us when we pick up a stray that's injured, hurt, or needs extreme medical care. It helps defer the cost for us. So next time you get your dog license, please pick up the special heart tag.
The Lorain County Commissioners would like to welcome you to come down to the Lorain County Dog Kennel. We also have a website that you can check out. Just click on Dogs to Adopt. There's plenty of dogs to choose from. It's like this little girl right here. This is Sadie. You can come down, make sure it's a good match for you. Take the dog out, take it for a walk. But please, if you're thinking about adopting a dog, come out to the Lorain County Dog Kennel and see if there's a match for you.
Give the Lorain County Dog Kennel a call or check their website for photos of currently available dogs. Remember, your best friend is just waiting for you.
Welcome to another broadcast of the Lorain County Commissioners' General Meeting. Unless otherwise announced, meetings are held Thursday mornings at 9:30 at the Lorain County Administration Building, 226 Middle Avenue, 4th floor, downtown Elyria. These are public meetings, and as always, you are invited to attend.
Can we stand for the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank
you. Commissioner Blair has the dog today. Welcome to the Thursday, September 3rd, 2009 Board of Commissioners meeting.
Oh, and what a dog it is. Oh, he's so precious. I think Jack was looking at some old pictures of my dog and found this fella to bring today. Oh, is he ever a priceless little puppy? Good morning. This week's featured pet is a male lab mix. Stray, found in North Ridgeville. He is in cage 35 and is eligible for adoption Saturday, September 5th at 3 p.m. very gentle dog. Labs make good pets. We had one for years, or rather two, a mother and child combination. So stop at our dog pound and see what we have for you, or check us on the website. Make somebody happy at your house.
Thank you, Commissioner. No quote this morning. As you're well aware, most people are. Commissioner Kukowski is out. She had major surgery 2 weeks ago, but she is recovering. We hope to have her back next week. So if you can keep her in her prayers, we'd appreciate it. Madam Clerk?
We have a proclamation.
You have it? Yep. Okay. Elaine, we're going to come up there and we'll do the proclamation.
Good morning, Elaine.
In the matter of proclaiming September 2009 as National Alcohol and Drug Addiction Recovery Month in Lorain County, whereas treatment and recovery improve the community's welfare and provide a renewed outlook on life for those who struggle with substance use disorders and their family and friends, and whereas 23.2 million people aged 12 or older in the United States needed treatment for a substance use disorder in 2007, and 5.4 million adults also suffered from a concurrent mental illness, and whereas studies have indicated 8.9% of people who made an effort to get treatment but did not receive it were concerned that receiving treatment might cause neighbors or community members to have negative opinions of them. However, most say they would not have a negative opinion of a relative or friend in recovery from an addiction. And whereas resources exist online and in our community to increase people's awareness about how substance use disorders affect children, families, and our society, and whereas such education is essential to overcoming misconceptions and achieving long-term recovery, and whereas to help achieve this goal, the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration, the White House Office of National Drug Control Policy, and the Alcohol and Drug Addiction Services Board of Lorain County invite all residents of Lorain County, Ohio, to participate in the 20th anniversary of National Alcohol and Drug Addiction Recovery Month. Therefore, by the Lorain County Board of Commissioners, by virtue of the authority vested in me by the laws of Lorain County, we do hereby proclaim the month of September 2009 as National Alcohol and Drug Addiction Recovery Month. Board of Commissioners, Ted Kahlo, Betty Blair, Lori Kukowski. Elaine?
Thank you. On behalf of those individuals and families either currently suffering in treatment or now in recovery for substance abuse and addiction, we thank you for this proclamation. It's testimony that, you know, this is our month to celebrate that treatment does work and people recover. So if we can all, you know, acknowledge, we probably all know somebody, either personally, someone we work with, or in our neighborhood that is going through this. Again, if it's time to take a minute to think that we have the support here in our community. As you said, there are resources. Even though we did get budget cuts, all of our programs are still intact. There might be a little bit longer waiting list, but we do have resources in Lorain County as well. So thank you for the proclamation and considering this month.
Thank you, Elaine.
And for the work that you do.
Thank you. I have one other item on the agenda. Actually, it's John Ellis from my board, but I'm also on this piece, if I could take a minute. One of our initiatives is Communities That Care of Lorain County. We've received our second year of funding from the Office of National Drug Control Policy for drug-free communities, and we wanted to just inform of a training that's coming. It's a free training for the community. It's called The Adolescent Brain Under Construction. It'll be presented on Wednesday, September 16th. At 5:30 in the evening at the Spitzer Conference Center. It's free, open to the public. We just ask people to call for reservations, 282-9920. And there are flyers in the back as well as you have them, because as we know, adolescents are adolescents. And as we move forward with drug-free communities, that's part of our first piece of education. The final piece is starting next Monday, actually. Over 14,000 students in all the public school districts of the county in grades 6, 8, 10, and 12 will be surveyed through the Communities That Care Youth Survey. And it's basically going to give us information about what it's like to live in Lorain County from their perspective. So once we get all that data back, probably in the winter, we're going to provide you with a lot more detail on what they feel it's like to live in this county. So on behalf of our board and our providers, I'd like to thank you for your continuing support. And have a great September.
Thank you,
Elaine.
Under resolutions number one, job and family services bills.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Investments.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Appropriations.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Transfers.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Requisitions.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Travel expenses.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Bills.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Under the airport, instruct the clerk to advertise for bids for the agricultural land use of the airport. Notice to be in the Chronicle and Rural Urban on September 8th and 15th and open at 2 p.m. on September 25th in meeting room D.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Under the Commissioners, authorize various personnel actions as indicated on the summary sheet for employees within jurisdiction of Commissioners.
Mr. Cordez.
Thank you, Commissioner. I do have a number of issues that I want to discuss with the board. Some hires at Golden Acres. I do have some additional layoffs that I need to discuss with you with Job and Family Services. And we have a pending labor agreement that we may or may not discuss. I know time is short this morning. They're all permissible topics under the Sunshine Law, so I would request that we have an executive session at the conclusion of our regular board meeting today to do so. Thank you.
Approve and waive the reading of the same for the Lorain County Board of Commissioners meeting minutes for August 6th, 13th, and 19th.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Authorize the county to quit claim ownership of the 5-acre Powers parcel and the 10-acre York parcel, the parcel with the building from itself to itself relating to Green Acres.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Cordez.
Yes, sir.
This is going to tie them all together as one parcel or to split apart? I was kind of confused when we met with Flanagan 2 weeks ago and we were at the fair all week, so I didn't get clarification.
Actually, my understanding of this is going to split the one parcel apart.
I know we've worked on this for 4 years, so I mean, we're doing
it for 14
longer
years
than that. Okay.
The four years I've been here, I know we've worked on it.
What we have here is we have different restrictions on different portions of the entire parcel at Green Acres, the way it was deeded and willed and restricted 100 years ago.
Right.
Somewhere along the journey, somebody combined all those parcels into one parcel. And that was probably for ease of reporting, and I probably would have recommended doing the same thing. But now that we're still trying to deal with that land issue with the restrictions on a portion, there's no need to restrict all those parcels with the arduous requirements of the one. So we're going back out, splitting the parcels back out so we can deal with each one of them individually rather than having to deal with them together.
Thank you for the clarification.
Mr. Kayla?
Aye.
Ms. Blair?
Aye.
Instruct the clerk to advertise for bids for the Transportation Center Phase 2 Audio-Visual Technology Contract. Notice to be in the Journal on September 8th, 15th, and 22nd. Mandatory pre-bid at 9 a.m. on September 23rd at the site and open at 2:30 p.m.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla?
Aye.
Ms. Blair?
Aye.
Instruct the clerk to advertise for the bids for the Transportation Center Phase 2 Warming Kitchen Equipment and Contract. Notice to be in the Chronicle on September 8th, 15th, and 22nd. Mandatory pre-bid at 10 a.m. on September 23rd at the site and open at 3 p.m.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Award various contracts for mechanical, plumbing, and electrical work for the train station maintenance facility. Bids were open on August 20th, and these were the most responsive complying with specifications paid from the transit construction account. Issue notice to proceed letter honor before September 10th and complete honor before November 14th. Authorize county administrator to notify the county auditor to release retainage at completion of said project. One, Firelands Electric Lorain in the amount of $62,125 for electrical. Lucas Plumbing and Heating in the amount of $100,900 for mechanical plumbing.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Approve change order number one to Lucas Plumbing and Heating Lorain in the amount of $19,050 for additional plumbing work, modifications to storm and sanitary sewer system at the Transportation Center to be paid from Q construction account.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Commissioner, just for the record, since we've dealt with several issues with the Transportation Center, and since we are working very diligently in the community to maintain our current sales tax, I'd like to point out that this is federal money. Not local money that is supplying these projects. There is no additional local money or new local monies going into this project with regard to continuing to try to get this Transportation Center completed by the end of the year. A lot of people ask out there because they just don't understand the division of funds.
That's normally Commissioner Kukowski brings that up, and she didn't think to add that to it.
So I just want to make sure in her memory, that while she's not here this week, we'll bring it up and make sure that
her
well, not mean memory, but yes. I guess bad choice of words, thank God. But out of respect for her, how's that? The public needs to know that we're not using local dollars for this project. I get approached on that all the time, and I'm sure you do too.
Yes, we do.
Thank you.
Urge Congress to fully fund the $475 million Great Lakes Restoration Initiative in the President's 2010 budget proposal. These dollars will keep Lake Erie recreational, vital, and economically productive for this generation and many generations to come.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion.
Yes. The Board of Commissioners of Lorain County received a letter from Tina Skelton Wozniak, who's the President of the Board of the Lucas County Commissioners, basically Toledo, asking all of the counties along Lake Erie to urge Congress to support these dollars towards recreational development and economic development. So we received the letter last week, and our clerk was able to get it on our board business this week, urging Congress, along with Congresswoman Marcy Kaptur, Congresswoman Betty Sutton, Senator Voinovich, and Senator Brown to please keep this going forward and funding it. So thank you very much.
Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Under Community Development, award a contract to Bridge Building Company Lorain in the amount of $2,390, which includes a 10% contingency for any unforeseen changes for Kathy Nelson at 39568 Carroll Lane, Carlisle Township, to receive a grant for roof venting and repairs and wall and ceiling repairs at the kitchen stove and wall tile replacement at the kitchen stove. This is the most responsive bid complying with specifications and will be paid from the CDBG FY08 home repair account.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Support the annual comprehensive economic development strategies update for 2009-2010.
So moved.
Second. And Mr. Chairman, do we want to hear from Rebecca?
Rebecca, you want to fill us in?
Good morning, Commissioners. As you know, annually we are required to prepare a community economic development strategy, which is then submitted to the Economic Development Administration for potential funding for local economic development projects here in Lorain County. We've actually been quite successful in the past. Lorain and Elyria both have received funding. This year, the number one ranked public works project again is the water tower at the former Ford Lorain plant in the city of Lorain. We understand that EDA has asked for a pre-application, and this is moving along and should actually be funded through the EDA this year. So this is the second year that it's ranked number one, and we are very hopeful that the funding will be received for this project. In addition, Mayor Hunter in Sheffield Village would like to open up 200 acres by connecting two industrial parks in his village. And he had asked that this be placed on the SEDS because of the unemployment rates in Lorain County. The entire county is eligible this year to receive EDA funding. So we have also placed that one and the Pin Oak Parkway extension in the city of Avon Lake, which would allow for the extension of their industrial park. So we have three projects ranked this year. And the number one project is moving forward on the fast track to actually receive financing through EDA. So
Wonderful.
We're pretty excited about that.
Great. Thank you, Rebecca.
Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Our sanitary authorized a second extension of time to execute a contract with United Survey Incorporated, Oakwood Village, for the Crest Haven Eaton Home Sanitary Sewer Reconstruction Phase 1, Contract 1, for 120 days.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Under Workforce, approve and enter into various purchase service contracts with Lorain County Workforce Development Agency with funds available through WIA effective July 1st, 2009 through September 30, 2009. YWCA Soft Skills in School Youth, $10,000. Boys and Girls Club Work Experience, $44,000. YWCA Internship, $20,000. Urban League Tutoring Mentoring, $10,000. Boys and Girls Club Tutor Mentoring, $10,000. And Domestic Relations Juvenile Court, $3,750.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Amendment Resolution 09188 adopted March 19, 2009, designating commissioners as fiscal agent effective July 1st, 2009 for Workforce Development Agency, and amend Resolution 09441, adopted June 25, 2009, amending Resolution 09391, adopted June 4th, approving and entering purchase service contracts with Workforce Institute for the Operation of Employment Network One-Stop Career Center. Said amendments are to reflect the wording authorized said payments.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
May I just point out now that...
It's like a cleanup move to me.
It is. Yeah. There is so much going on with stimulus dollars and workforce development that we're moving in and out of grants and applying for monies at a rapid pace, and we're trying to catch up with ourselves here. So this is housekeeping onto some of our contracts, because there were some waivers that were applied by the state that allowed us to extend contracts while we were waiting on additional allocations. But we needed to follow up with the resolutions, and I apologize that it took so long to get this, but we need to house clean these things.
That's what it looked like.
Thank you.
Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Instruct clerk to advertise for bids for Russia Road resurfacing project. Notice to be in the Chronicle on September 4th, 11th, and 18th, and bids to be open at 2 p.m. on September 29th.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Authorize county engineer to sign the acknowledgement on behalf of the county for the new outfall and legal description of the sewer and easement to Fireland School District, Vermillion Road. The existing outfall sewer is failing and is in sufficient capacity for the drainage area being served. Water from Vermillion Road, which is a county road, drains into this outfall, so the engineer has interest in seeing the outfall replaced. The easement is granted to Fireland School District with acknowledgement by the county to routine maintenance and minor repairs on the new 30-inch sewer line. Fireland's local school district Board of Education will pay $1 to Shirley Ann McGuire as executor of the last will and testament to Wilford T. Cunningham, a.k.a. Troy Cunningham, a.k.a. W.T. Cunningham, a.k.a. Wilford T. Cunningham.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Mr. Cortez, County Administrator.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. As I said, I know Commissioner Cagle has to leave early this morning, so I'll be brief. Two things. First, I once again have the prescription drug program, the NACO prescription drug program that we're part of, and we've been part of since 2006. And I'm pleased to report that we're approaching $500,000 worth of savings for our county residents for this no-cost program that we're enrolled in, vis-a-vis our membership in the National Association. So that's always nice to take a look at that number. So if anybody needs those cards, please contact the commissioner's office, specifically Sandy Strozak at 329-5760, and she can point you in the right direction for getting a card if you have an issue with not having prescription drug coverage.
Well, actually, not to continue on that, though, my assistant, Tony Ann, drops those off at the local pharmacies.
I thought you did. That's what I didn't want to. So. That would be great. So I think that the program's picking up a lot of steam and a lot of people are taking advantage of it. And I like to report that out so that occasionally people know that there is benefit to those memberships. The other thing is that, which is not as pleasant news, is that I received on the end of August the reports on the sales tax revenue from the general fund. And unfortunately, and I'm sure you've seen this, through August 24th of this year, the 0.5% that supports the general fund operations is down $1,122,000. The 0.25% that supports the jail operation is down $522,000. So we have roughly $1.6 million of decreased revenue from sales tax at this point last year. I'll pass this along. I'm not sure if you saw it. I just got through my folder myself. But the news continues to be discouraging. Hopefully September we may see an uptick in some of the sales tax from the cash for clunkers. I know that there was a lot of activity with the dealerships. How much that's going to be, I don't know, but that's going to be a one-shot deal too, because those programs only ran in for a short time and during a specific time period. I think it's important that we report out that we continue to see a decline in the revenues within Lorain County as we approach November, and we attempt to convince the public that we need to maintain this sales tax to maintain a safe community. Thank you.
Mr. Ennis, Assistant County Prosecutor.
Commissioners, I have no report this morning.
Commissioners, report.
It's nice to be back in our offices. Last week was the county fair. Very successful. I spent 6 days out there, and speaking for the criminal justice tax, We were given issue number 4, so everyone's aware it will be on the ballot. There's 3 state issues, and it's the county's turn this year to be on top. So all our dialogue with the residents last week, I think we're very positive. We had a lot of good response. I know I met with Captain Drozdowski and myself and Sheriff Stamitti and Prosecutor Will were on both WEOL and WOBL talking about the county needs, and our safety comes first. So we're going to be urging everyone to look at issue 4 and after much consideration, approve it. Thank you. End of my report. Go ahead. No, I was going to do this. I would tweet them all bumped together, I think.
Are you done?
Yes, I am finished, Commissioner.
I'm pleased to announce that the West Shore Commuter Rail Task Force, together with the Jet Express, in conjunction with the alternative analysis launching, is having a recognition event on the Jet Express on September the 30th. It's Wednesday. It's $25 per person leaving from the Black River Landing. And if that isn't enough, Jet Express is also having 3 trips to the Browns. The dates are Sunday, September 13th, Sunday, October 4th, and Sunday, October 25th. I've given those dates and times to Hal, but if you didn't get it and you need them, I have them. And if anybody has an interest, you're welcome to attend. The West Shore Commuter Rail is a Wednesday evening from 5:30 to 8. The Jet Express will depart at 6 p.m. from the Black River Landing.
Thank you.
The Browns, they're leaving at 11. And Commissioner Kahlo didn't mention the buyers at the fair, but I'm sure that he bought a lot of stuff because that's what he feeds his family during the year. I just brought my annual turkey, and it was fun to be there. It's fun to help the kids, and it's fun to participate in the watching all the goings on. And finally, I'd like to say that Mayor Kersenko and I were asked to give out awards at the Blessings Outreach Festival that was held a week ago Saturday, I think. And there were some 30 recipients, and it was very nice to see these people honored. It was kind of a surprise to me that on item number whatever, I also received one of the awards. John Hunter and I received awards as public officials, and mine says as an inspiration in politics. So I want you guys to pay attention. Now I'm an inspiration, okay? And here it is, if you can
yes,
pick it
you
up.
Are.
Yeah, right. I won't ask you what kind of an inspiration. So I thank Lou Acosta and his committee for recognizing, and it was nice to be there. And the article in the paper said they even gave thanks for the rain because it rained that day. And then they're an inspirational group of people. And last but not least, my favorite dinner of the year is, I looked at Elizabeth and I remember the Women's Equality Dinner in Oberlin, because those folks don't let you forget that we gals are equal to you guys. That's it.
Board correspondence.
Move the reading be waived.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Kahlo.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Public comment.
Anyone wishing to address the board? Good morning, Shirley.
Shirley R. Johnson, Oberlin. I'd like to refer you back to item number 12 about Green Acres and ask a little further what the possible import of that might be in terms of if too much land, I have no clue how the land is laid out there and what the parcels are, but geez.
It's a blessing.
It's fighting me. What the consequences might be for the building itself, which I gather is the only thing there that is required to be used for a specific reason. I would hate to think it would be left with less land for, say, children to play in or whatever it might its future use might be.
Well, currently, Shirley, and what I've been working on, I've just been here 4 years, just 4 years.
Seems like forever.
Seems like forever, especially with you, Commissioner.
Yeah, right on.
But anyway, just any usage for that facility, and it is aging and been closed up, surely.
I know.
We have to look at other options for that facility, and there's a deed process that we're working through. and all these things we're finding with the properties were all joined together. So, I mean, currently we don't have anything going out there, but it would be nice to someday, you know, make it fruitful and a benefit to the community again, but the properties are all mixed together. So, do you want to add on to it?
I don't think that 2 or 3 months goes by when I'm not contacted by Green Acres from somebody who wants to start a school or a daycare or a business out there. There's probably been, over the last 5 years, 50 contacts with regard to the property and its uses, and each and every one of those has to be turned back because of the restrictions. Right now, some of the restrictions were modified, but anything that goes in there has to be pretty much for a public use and has to support, 75% of the support has to be for children. And
say that again.
75% of the services produced there would have to be for children. It's been difficult to blend those services together without violating the deed restrictions with regard to property use. The ball fields that occupy the north side of the property and a portion of what used to be the soccer fields on the west side of the property were once an independent parcel of land that was freed from restrictions in the late 90s. The parcel that the building proper sits upon, and I'm trying to recall this from memory now, is the parcel that has the greatest deed restriction placed upon it. Separating them gives us the ability to deal more fully with lifting the restriction on the smaller parcel that the building sits upon, because we have identified known heirs that have to be specifically dealt with to modify those deed restrictions. Overall, with my discussion with each of the commissioners, we have not actually strategized a complete plan for what to do with the property, but this is a positioning for higher ground with regard to trying to release the property that the building's upon. Once that happens, I believe the intent would be, in some discussions over years now, would be to sell that property so that it could become a productive piece of property out in Oberlin. Right now, it's been boarded up for 14 years, and while we make sure it doesn't attract the wrong element and we keep the grounds cleaned, we definitely would like to see it put back on the roles of producing property for the city.
Is there any place, where is the place that one can go to see how the property is now divided?
Right now you can probably look the parcel up on the auditor's website. It's still contained as one large parcel. I don't believe you'll see any division. This is going back to title records for 100 years, and that all that information would be contained within the prosecutor's office, because they're the legal representatives working on it.
Well, will it show what you've done today? I mean, the quit claims and how they're...
I don't think it'll show anything about what we've done today, and that'll probably take several days or a few weeks to catch up with the posting downstairs. But I'm sure you see Mr. Flanagan here, and Mr. Flanagan may be able to give you a more complete explanation of that, because he's our legal representative working on that.
Mr. Flanagan?
Yes, Bob Flanagan over in the prosecutor's office.
I can't quite understand you.
I'm sorry, Bob Flanagan over in the prosecutor's office.
Okay. Thank you.
Hi, Sherry Penna. I work for Commissioner Kukoski. It's kind of strange to be standing up here. But since she is not here, I know that she would want to say something about this. I'm sure everybody read about it in the newspaper. I have a memo from Ford, Ohio Assembly Plant, regarding David Hall, the Marine that was killed in action while he was serving this great country. He's the son of Dell Hall, who is also an employee at the plant. David began working for the company on July 31st, 2000. And I just wanted to have a moment of silence for him, if we could.
Without a doubt.
Thank you.
Thanks, Rick. Give our best to Lori. Anyone else looking to address the board? I move we go into executive session as outlined above.
I'll second.
Mr. Kayla.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
Thank you.
Unless otherwise announced, meetings are held Thursday mornings at 9:30 at the Lorain County Administration Building, 226 Middle Avenue, 4th floor, downtown Elyria. These are public meetings, and as always, you are invited to attend.
On April 1st, 2010, our nation will be counted. Every person, whoever they are, wherever they live. And what we learn will transform what we know about ourselves. The 2010 Census, it's a new portrait of America. The 2010 Census is an exciting milestone for America. It promises to deliver accurate information about our diverse and growing population. And it's important for the future of every community. Census data will be used to allocate over $300 billion in federal funds every year.
The 2010 Census will be important to the nation because it is the foundation of our democracy.
The Census, no matter when it is the consummate partnership between local, state, and federal government.
Communities use the data to plan for their future, like disaster and emergency services, healthcare services, schools, transportation, libraries, senior centers, and more. The 2010 Census builds on the success of previous censuses and is the best planned and most well-researched census ever. And innovations, like a new short census form, will help to make it even more successful. The 2010 Census, it's easy to complete. Data are always confidential and safeguarded. It's important.
This census is a commitment to the American way of life. To be counted as a resident of the United States, I think, is one of the proudest things that can happen to you in this country. It's important. Stand up for yourself. Be counted. Let people know you're out there.
The 2010 Census. It's a new portrait of America.
Photograph, a time and place, a picture holds a moment's space, a portrait of hopes and dreams, telling the story of our times. And for now we know that we're changing. America, let's celebrate. We're proud and we stand tall. Together, a portrait of us all.
The 2010 Census. It's a new portrait of America.
Pedestrian injuries represent the second largest number in motor-related deaths. In the current report by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, of the 812 traffic fatalities for children ages 5 to 9, almost one-third, that's 254, were pedestrian fatalities. These numbers were just very staggering to me in this office. Most of these were from pedestrian crossings, children not educated in crossing streets where there are sidewalks and obviously stoplights, or where there are no sidewalks and there are stop signs. So basically, it was based on the fact that they aren't getting proper education or they hadn't any education on how to cross streets with sidewalks or without sidewalks. So that's what really got us motivated to look into this and do something about it.
County Engineer's Office is quite proud to announce that the Safe Routes to School program has been initiated throughout Lorain County. We're very excited about this. To help these children from grades K to 4, teaching them to walk the streets safely is very important to us. We've seen statistics that quite frankly shock us. Many times we read and see stories of pedestrians being hit by automobiles in Lorain County, and it just tears my heart to see these children from K to 4 part of that. This program is to stop that or help diminish those type of situations and educate these children on walking and crossing the street safely. And we're quite happy to announce that.
Most of our workshop was developed and made in-house. Simulated sidewalks, simulated streets. We have actual working stoplights. We have the pedestrian crossing signs that actually work. We have operational railroad crossings. We also have the regular road signs, like your pedestrian crossing, your stop sign, your railroad sign. So we have all of these different things that the children can not only visualize, but then we actually interact the children in those situations so they can not only see, but they can use these in their learning abilities on how to cross the streets with and without sidewalks. We've had so many good responses back from the children, and of course, it's just like anything else with children. When you ask for volunteers, when you're talking in a group of 60 and you can only have 8, it's amazing at the hands that go up. You know, does anybody want to volunteer? Well, everybody wants to volunteer. We make them go over these skills that we're trying to teach them, not only the volunteers, but the group as a whole. So basically, we have the whole class interacting. So if they say left, right, left, behind you, in front of you once, they say it at least 8 or 10 times before the workshop is over. So we've had many teachers and many principals tell us, and we even had one child that came up to us and said, you know what, Ms. Spansky, we were going across the street the other day and we remembered look left, look right, look left. So that was very rewarding. And so I think the repetition, the interaction with the children and with the items in our workshop is very important to them and to us. Before you even go into the safety part of it, they're in awe over the traffic light, and then our railroad crossing signals actually work. So they're just like, oh, ooh. And we get up there and we tell them, and we even give them some trick questions. You know, we'll say, well, we can see that train all the way down the track. Do you think we can make it? Because you're fast and I'm fast and we can run. And of course, they're very enthusiastic and no, we shouldn't do this. So we teach them that in some urban areas, you will not have the gates that come down to keep you actually from crossing, that you may just have two sets of tracks. And just because one goes by and the signals stop doesn't mean that another one can't come from the other direction. So we tell them it's very, very imperative that they stay back from the tracks and they wait till those signals stop and to look both ways. And even once those signals stop, to look both ways, and they should never run across the railroad tracks. They should walk and continue to look both ways because it's not safe. And they could fall, they could injure themselves. If they're alone, if they're not with someone, it could be very dangerous because not only could they injure themselves, they may not have help if there is a train coming because they are so small. And as you know, some of those tracks are very large, and you're talking in kindergarten through fourth grade, some of those children are very small children. The main thing is that we tell them that only you know when it's safe. You have to make that ultimate decision. So make sure that you know that it's safe before you cross those railroad tracks or a street. One of the other things that we cover in the safety workshop, and it's also repeated in our video, children don't have that perception of the miles per hour. It's very dangerous. And the same thing with trains. We tell them that train could take, you know, forever. It's way down there. But we don't know the actual miles per hour. We decided to use two different videos. The first one is geared for kindergarten and first grade, and that is Otto the Otto, put out by AAA.
Hi, kids. A lot of times you have to walk to get to places. And when you're walking, you have to be especially careful of cars and bicycles. Oh no, those kids are walking the wrong way. That's dangerous. I'm going to talk with these kids. Down at the clubhouse, they're talking about the safe way to walk on streets without sidewalks.
I say you can walk across the street anywhere you want, as long as you look first.
And don't get squished flat by a car.
That's a fairly simple way of looking at safety. There are actual rules and laws for walking.
Yeah, but the most important one is you don't get squished flat.
Who's right, Maggie? Patrick or us?
I guess in a sense, everyone's right. The main idea is to get there safely, but there are some rules to help you get there safely, like don't run out into the street without looking.
The second video, we show second, third, and fourth grade. And it is put together by the National Safety Council along with Honda, and they developed the first humanoid robot.
How come you dressed in a robot suit?
It's not a suit. I'm a real robot. My name, Osimo, stands for Advanced Step in Innovative Mobility. I'm the world's most advanced humanoid robot. I can walk forwards, backwards, and even climb stairs just like a human. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, what's the first rule about crossing the street?
Stopping at curbs.
Correct. First, always stop at the curb. Then make sure no cars are coming. You want to look left.
It's clear.
Then right to see if any cars are coming from the other direction.
That's clear too.
Cars move fast. There might already be a new car to the left. So look left again.
Car coming.
See what I mean?
Okay, he's gone.
Kids love this. They relate to Osimo as well as the younger children relate to Otto, who is an animated automobile, and he tells them about crossing streets. Osimo does the same thing, and he actually goes through with the children and tells them how to cross the street at an intersection with a traffic light, with a pedestrian crossing. He also teaches them how to cross because a lot of children at schools have parked cars. He goes over the issues of how to cross when there are parked cars. So he does a number of different things, how to cross the street when there are no sidewalks. So they both cover the basic skills. One is just geared a little bit more for the different age groups. Our response has been amazing. Not only from the children, we have received numerous cards. I have a whole box of thank yous from children from the schools that have participated in our workshop. We've had nothing but a positive response back throughout the communities that we visited this year.
I think it was really nice because they had a real life robot talk to you about safety, and you got to actually do what he said was safe. He said when there are parked cars to make sure there are no drivers in before you cross the street.
I saw that we could know what to do when there's like cars coming, not to go in the middle of the road so you don't get hurt. You have to look left, right, left, behind the shoulder, and then straight. If they don't know how to stop at sidewalks, then I'll tell them how to. If they don't know how to cross with the outside box, then I'll tell them how to do that too, because that's what we learned.
I think that it was good because I didn't know that you had the five ways, which were left, right, left, and then over your shoulder, and then ahead of you.
I thought that crossing the road was really good for little kids if they don't know what to do by crossing the road.
It's a good idea because, like I said, the kids could walk through the whole process of crossing streets with the crosswalk, without a crosswalk, at the intersection, what happens if you're crossing in between two parked cars. Those are things that parents don't teach their kids. They go to Safety Town and they learn left, look right, look left again, and they go. And even my own son, who's a kindergartner, he just did Safety Town, and I still catch him flying across the street. And all I have to do is say, Matthew, remember Osimo? And he stops and he thinks and he does all the steps that he was taught in the video.
It was a great refresher, especially Absolutely. For them, now knowing, you know, what to do and kind of even an additional things that they may not have been told or considered before.
Most of the kids did their little safety program back when they were getting ready to go to kindergarten. They start out learning all those safety rules. Then as time goes on, if you don't reinforce those safety rules and keep telling them, just like we do as adults, we think we're safe. We don't have to follow those rules anymore. We can do what we want. We can take a chance and run across the road. And I think this program was very good at reinforcing the fact that even though we're growing up, we still have to be careful. We still have to follow the signs. We still have to follow the railroad crossings, especially around here in Amherst. We tend to have a little trouble with the railroad crossings and kids wanting to play on them. So I think it was a good review. I think it was done in a fun learning way, and the kids really enjoyed it. We were very happy to have everyone here at St. Joseph's School.
If it saves one life, we feel like we've made a contribution. It's our way to give back to the communities.
Okay. No one can deny the loving devotion we get from our dogs, and I think we all agree we get back more love than we give them. I'm Dick Goddard. I'm reminding you, if you share your love with a dog, you'll never regret it. There's really nothing like a dog to spark up your life, whether you're a youngster, a senior citizen, or somewhere in between. And dogs have a whole lot of affection to share. Okay, is that good? You don't have to go far to hear heartwarming adoption stories.
With my husband is like saying man's best friend. He truly loves that dog. He feels it's part human. It's his second daughter, as Erica said. It's definitely a prize. She's queen of the house, basically. She's a good lover. She gives us a lot of attention. She's a good girl.
We had a cat before. We had Abby. And Abby adapted very well. She is best friends with that cat. She will not harm that cat in any way. She's amazing. I love her. When I'm in bed at night, Abby will jump up with me and she will pull the covers back and she will lay under the covers and lay her head on the pillow just like a human.
I encourage anyone to go to the Lorain County Kennel to adopt a dog. It's given our family great satisfaction and a great reward.
after, you know, a bad day at work, or anytime you come home, it's just always nice. They kind of turn your mood around once they come, when you come in the door, and they wagging their tails and jumping on you, and it's a great feeling to know that they're happy to see you and that they love you just as much as you love them. She is good with our other dog. She's good with people. She likes attention, and she likes to cuddle up with you.
It's funny when Lily, when you kind of discipline her sometimes when she does something bad, or she always seems to roll on her back and put her paws in the air and just look up at you with a sad look. So it's kind of hard to even get mad at her when she does something like that. So we kind of laugh at that.
And it's always amusing when she does get a spurt of energy and want to run around, and we're always like, oh my gosh, Lily's gonna play now.
Yeah, so when I'm on the couch or whatever, and she'll hop down, and she always like tries to bite her own tail, and then that kind of like keys on our other dog, Rocky, to chime in and try to, you know, bite her tail a little bit, and then they start playing around a little bit.
One day we came home with some food from, I just really wanted a burger. So we had a burger, and I had it sitting on the tray table by the couch, and I got up for a minute and got a drink, came back, and Lily was licking her lips. She had eaten the whole thing, and I was not very happy with her. So I screamed and told Kurt to come down and get her away from me because I was just so upset. But we both lived, and I was fine afterwards. One of the best things about adopting a dog from the kennel, at least for us, was, again, just giving this dog, who knows what would have happened to her, a new life, and also giving our other dog a companion during the day. It's just fun to have the two dogs and take them for walks and watch them play, and it brought us closer as well.
You know, it just makes you feel better as a person that, you know, you're giving a dog a better chance to live a life.
Actually, I enjoy the exercise because I need to, trying to lose weight. Salem makes me get out of the house every day. And so I have to take him for a walk, even if I don't want to. And he's not that much trouble because he was pretty much housebroken when I got him from the pound. I really like the older pet because Salem was kind of, whoever had him before, they really kind of housebroken. So I didn't really have to go through the potty training deal. I just had to let him out and find a place for him to go. And I think older pets, especially for people who don't have children, are kind of good because Salem, he's real playful, but he's not, he gets tired and he lays down and he doesn't want to be bothered. And that's fine with me. So he's not always wanting to play, you know, because puppies have a lot of energy. And Salem has quite a bit of energy, but sometimes he just lays on his pillow and he's like, don't bother me, I won't bother you. And sometimes when he wants to play, he wants to play, and that's okay. I got Salem at the Lorain County Dog Pound. I found him on the internet, actually. They had his picture on the internet, and so I called and he was still there. And so I immediately went over and looked at him. We went outside and played, and he jumped in the car and wouldn't get out, and there we were. So we were on our way home. So it was love at first sight. He's a very good companion. I can always depend on him to be here and greet me with, you know, open arms when I come in the door. He's very protective of me, and he lets me know when anyone is outside or in the driveway. So I feel safe with Salem, you know, even though he's a small dog, he gives me a safe feeling just in my own home. If I'm having a bad day sometimes and I'm just not in a real good mood, you know, he'll come up and snuggle up to me like, hey, Mom, it's okay. I think other people should adopt a pet, and even an older dog. The Lorain County Pound has so many wonderful dogs. All you have to do is go over there and look. I mean, even now, I still go on the website and I tell Salem, don't you want a little brother or sister? Because they have all these little cute dogs over there, and they all need good homes. And if you're looking to adopt a pet, I suggest you try the Lorain County Dog Pound first. I mean, you pay for the license and just a nominal fee, and you got a great dog and a great companion and somebody that's going to be in your life for the rest of your life and they'll love you no matter what.
Hello, my fellow commissioners and I are here at the Lorain County Dog Kennel on Hadaway Street, just south of Eluri City Discount, Value City. We invite you to stop out and see the facility here. We have lots of dogs available for adoption. We also encourage all dog owners to register your dog each year and get a dog license. That's your dog's ticket home in case it gets lost. It has a number and can easily be identified so that your dog can be returned to you in case he or she might take a little walk and you are unaware of it.
Along with the regular licensing that the county requires for all dogs, we also have a special dog license. It's a special heart medical care license tag for an additional $5. And the proceeds from that go to help us when we pick up a stray that's injured, hurt, or needs extreme medical care. It helps defer the cost for us. So next time you get your dog license, please pick up the special heart tag.
The Lorain County Commissioners would like to welcome you to come down to the Lorain County Dog Kennel. We also have a website that you can check out. Just click on Dogs to Adopt. There's plenty of dogs to choose from. It's like this little girl right here. This is Sadie. You can come down, make sure it's a good match for you. Take the dog out, take it for a walk. But please, if you're thinking about adopting a dog, come out to the Lorain County Dog Kennel and see if there's a match for you.
Give the Lorain County Dog Kennel a call or check their website for photos of currently available dogs. Remember, your best friend is just waiting for you.